So why on earth would anyone study history and philosophy of science? What's the point? I'm going to tell you the story of the 17-year-old Hakob. Oh, not this one. This one. 17-year-old Hakob. When I was 17, I was a bright kid, and I knew my science. I thought I knew my science. And somebody asked me, Hakob, what do you know about the history of science? Okay, you know your physics, chemistry, and so on and so forth. But what do you know about the history of science? What I would tell back then is pretty much along the lines what every high school kid, probably every talented high school kid, would say in response. This is basically what you find in popular science literature, or you find in science textbooks, or even in professional science accounts. This is what I call popular science mythology. And this is the story of the 17-year-old Hakob, which I think many of you would share. Slightly after the Big Bang, there were these weird guys called ancient Greeks. And these ancient Greeks, they were very, very bright guys because they tried to understand the universe, how the world works, what things are made of, and so on and so forth. But the trouble was they got all of it wrong. For instance, I knew back then, Plato would say that every object is made of tiny, tiny triangles. Aristotle believed that the earth was in the center of the universe. And this guy here, Hippocrates, would teach that human body is made of four bodily fluids, whatever those fluids are. And finally, that guy over there, Democritus, he actually believed that education is basically for the unfortunate. It's just one step from saying ignorance is bliss. So basically, this guy's got everything wrong. So it's not really surprising that back then there was no science whatsoever. What was there in abundance? Tons of religion. And the funny thing was that you could actually choose your religion. You could decide to pray to Greek gods or to your Egyptian gods. Or if you were so inclined, you could even choose to pray to the gods of the seven. Old gods, new gods. And you could even choose to pray to the Lord of Light, for the night is dark and full of terrors. But the thing is, this whole fun ended when Christians came along. They provided a religion that was supposed to be good for everyone, you know, one size fits them all. And the whole fun ended. They would teach, you know what they would teach. The God made everything, the universe, the mankind, all living things. And for a very long time, there was no science, just religion. Until some heroes of science appeared. And among those heroes was this guy, Galileo Galilei. He was the first brave enough to say everything he thought about the dogmatism and ignorance of the churchmen. Well, quite naturally, they didn't understand him, and they decided, well, to punish him. What they did, they tortured him, they imprisoned him, and he found himself in a situation when he knew all the right answers. It's just the right answers were not available. It was like that, right? He knew the right answer, it's just the right answer was not available. So what do?
Call a friend.
Call a friend, exactly. Luckily, he had friends. And with the help of these friends, like Copernicus and Newton, he managed to liberate science from religion. Hurrah! And that's where the real science began in the 17th century. They created the so-called scientific method. And with the help of this scientific method, they proved new and new theories. They discovered more and more facts. So that brought us to the contemporary science. And in the contemporary science, what have we? We have experiments, observations, none of that metaphysical nonsense about gods and religion and all sorts of things. Just experiments and observations. Nowadays, scientists believe that God does not exist. And finally, it is because of this scientific method that science is a rational activity. And it's this scientific method that allows us to demarcate proper science from pseudoscience. In a nutshell, my dear friends, this is what I think any educated high school kid thinks about science. This is pretty much the popular mythology of science, abundant everywhere. Watch science documentaries, read popular science literature, open science textbooks. This is what you get. Well, probably, you know, if you skip the Lord of Light part, everything else you pretty much get in abundance. Now, this was a story. But let's now try to be philosophers here and try to extract the basic myths on which this story is based. And this is exactly what I'm going to do now. Myth number one, science was created in the 17th century. Basically, that there was no science before that. This is myth number one. Myth number two, Galileo was a martyr of science. Basically, he was tortured and he was punished and he was treated unjustly. This is the second myth. The scientific revolution liberated science from religion. This is myth number three. Myth number four, the contemporary science believes that God does not exist. And myth number five, that contemporary science is all about observations and experiments, that it has nothing to do with metaphysical stuff, stuff that we cannot observe, that we cannot measure. It's all about observations. This is myth number five. Myth number six, science proves things. Myth number seven, the method of science is universal and unchangeable, meaning that the way we do science nowadays is the same as we used to do it 200 years ago, and it's exactly the same as it's going to be 300 years from now. It's unchangeable. Myth number eight, science is a rational enterprise because of its universal method. Nine, each succeeding theory encompasses more and more true facts. And finally, myth number 10, there is a strict demarcation line between science and pseudoscience. These are the 10 myths. I'm going to zoom out. If you pay attention, five of these myths are historical, and five of them are philosophical. Now my question is, does any of this hold water? Does this make sense? Is any of this true? Now that I told you that these are myths, you might be inclined to say, well, no, I never believed in this. It's only you, Hakob. But let's be honest here. How many of you, before my telling you that these were myths, would subscribe to something like this, give or take? How many of you? I like to see many brave people here. Very good. Now the thing is, this question here cannot have an answer unless you study history and philosophy of science. And that's why you need history and philosophy of science, to avoid ignorance. When you get people, very educated people, famous scientists saying everything right as far as science is concerned, but once they get to the history of science or philosophy of science, and they talk about these things, and you say, you cannot be this uneducated, can you? What we're doing here, we're fighting against basic ignorance. And that's why you need history and philosophy of science